My name is Ranthony Ashley Clark, and I am an NSFSN postdoc in the Department of Mathematics at Duke University. When I was young, I was always good at what I would call mathematical thinking. I was very inquisitive, very persistent, and I had so much fun in the figuring out process that involved problems. I remember in elementary school, my teacher introduced the concept of a palindrome, and I was fascinated because a palindrome could be a word, it could be a number. If you add two numbers, you know, how do you get it? Can you get another palindrome? Is there a pattern to that? And so I've always really loved puzzles. This idea of mathematical thinking has been natural. The idea of I am good at math, I'm proficient at this, you know, I have what it takes to be a mathematician. That I don't know if that's something that felt natural, if that's something that I felt was sort of in me. But this love of mathematics has always been there and always felt like a very natural thing based on the way I think. I always knew I loved mathematics, always, as far back as I can remember. Now, did mathematics love me back? This was the question that sort of pervaded my formative years. I was like, should I make this official? Should I go for it? Does she like me back? I don't know. And so when I was an undergrad, I was a biology major. I was pre-med. I wanted to be a doctor. And I think that the closest I have to a moment where I realized I'm going to go for it, I want to be a mathematician, was when I was in organic chemistry lab. And people were talking about their med school applications and they were so excited. And I was just like, meh, like I did not care. And here are these people, they wanted to help people. And I was like, well, you could help people with math. You could teach it. You could introduce people to it. I'm sure you can be a mathematician somehow or whatever. So my second semester of junior year, I changed my major to mathematics. I had no idea what I was going to do. I just knew that at that point in time, the study groups I was leading were the highlight of my week. And so I was like, maybe I can be a college math teacher. And I looked it up and I was like, well, I'm going to have to get a math degree and I'm going to have to try and get a PhD. And so this is sort of the moment where I, for better or for worse, just made this decision, and I haven't looked back since. So I do work in what's called quantitative justice. So I think a lot about how to apply rigorous theoretical and applied mathematical tools to social justice issues. I'm here at Duke, so I think a lot about the mathematics of redistricting. It is what gets me up in the morning. I find it fascinating and purposeful. And I'm here working with a group called Quantifying Gerrymandering that does this. And so I wear many mathematical hats. The work that I'm doing now is very interdisciplinary. So I'm using tools from what's called applied algebraic topology, where you think about, you know, the idea that topology helps you understand shape, and data has shape and shape has meaning. And so how can we apply these tools to understand the data that shows up in social issues like redistricting? My formal training is in theoretical math. I'm trained as a commutative algebraist, and now I'm doing all these applied things. And I want to share that because while that transition, you know, has had its moments, it's the sky is the limit and sort of the things that you can apply mathematical thinking to and mathematical tools to. And I'm having a blast. It's a really fun research community. It's new and it's emergent, and it feels so meaningful, and I'm happy to be a part of it. So I'd say that the majority of my struggles when I was an undergrad had to do with my approach to just doing math. I was very isolated. I declared my major very late as a junior. And so I didn't have any friends in the math major. I didn't feel particularly close to any of the professors. And so I just spent so much time alone. And that wrecked my confidence because I felt like, you know, is there a reason people aren't inviting me in? Is there something wrong with me? Is it because I'm a woman? Is it because of what? I don't know. I can never know, you know, and those feelings of just, am I good enough? I think come already when you're dealing with challenging material, but being so isolated was also very difficult. And then there's all the isms, classism, you know, where is my reimbursement? Like my credit card payment is due and I like don't want to have a really high account balance. There's classism, there's sexism, there's racism. I think that all the isms just form a great little package and can really wreak havoc on your ability to do the other hard thing, which is the math. I've known people who have had these moments and just decided to leave mathematics altogether. All that training, all that love, just gone because somebody was cruel and overtly racist or just like unkind. This has been an ongoing challenge and will continue to be, right? But I accept this as part of what it means to be in the math community. And I am driven to make it different and better for other people so that they don't have to deal with this nonsense. They can just go about the business of doing math that helps make the world a better place. I would say that the first thing that comes to mind when I think of my proudest accomplishment professionally would be getting this NSFSN postdoc. I want to provide some context. So before I heard about this postdoc, my back was against the wall. I'm laughing and I'm smiling now, but at that point in life, I was really unsure if academia was for me. I feel like you can love mathematics, enjoy doing it, but those things aren't synonymous with like doing it in an academic context. You can take those gifts, you can be in industry, you can do them recreationally, right? But just the thing that I was troubled and sort of really contemplating was, is academia for me as a mathematician? And the answer was, okay, I will stay if it looks like this, if I can work on problems like this, if I can find research environments like this, if I can, you know, have and find time to answer the kind of questions and do the sort of research that I would find really engaging, which at that point in time were more applied societal problems. I felt like, you know, math is a gift and I wanted to use it in the service of a better society. And so how can I do this and stay in academia knowing that its values aren't always aligned with that kind of work? And so I saw this postdoc opportunity. I shut myself in like a little room for a month and I just wrote down explicitly, okay, here is one concrete way I think I could use applied algebraic topology to study electoral redistricting. And I read articles about this and that, and I came out of it and I didn't even care if I got it. Just the practice of, I did this, I had an idea, I was feeling a certain kind of way, and I made a concrete action to change my reality. That was what I was proud of. And so that was probably my proudest mathematical accomplishment. And then one little quick, I guess, non-math accomplishment, I hit my step goal. So I just got a new smartwatch and it has like step goals for the month. And I wanted to get 300,000 for the month, which is about 10,000 a day. But you got some days where you don't do much. And so it kind of ebbs and flows. And I got down to the last day of the month and I needed 21,000 steps to hit the goal. And I needed to do it by 6 o'clock because I was hosting a movie night. And I did it. I did it by 5. And I was so happy and proud of myself. This just happened over the weekend. And so this also gets it like a work-life balance thing. But I those are two sort of accomplishments. One a little while ago and then one a couple of days ago. This may be surprising. But I feel as if I had absolutely no one championing me when I was younger. I just told myself that being a mathematician was a good idea and I should go for it with very little validation externally outside from like not terrible grades. The joke that I make is from Toy Story. There's this claw thing that gets those little aliens and then they get scooped up and they're just like, I have been chosen. And whenever the claw comes, they're like, the claw. And I think the analogy for mathematics is when I speak to people, there's usually some professor, some mentor, someone who's like, you will be a mathematician. You will do this REU. You will take this class. You will apply to these graduate schools. And then they just kind of get tapped. And then from there, that mixed with their affinity and love and gifts for math kind of propels them towards some sort of mathematical direction. I didn't have any of that. Like I was never told or chosen. And this made me feel sort of bitter for quite some time. And it wasn't until I got to graduate school that I really felt like I received a lot of hands-on mentoring. And before I was just kind of trying to figure it out. And so I'd say that in the absence of any one individual, there's been two things. Once I got to graduate school, I was part of networks for the first time. And from there, individual relationships formed. So I was part of the Edge community, and I still maintain close relationships and mentoring relationships with those women today. I was part of the National Math Alliance, and Phil Kutzko, the executive director at the time, was my mentor at University of Iowa and just kind of helped change my little life, you know. I would say that recently the quantifying gerrymandering group at Duke has been amazing. I would say that my community that I formed at SL Math when I did a semester program there last year, transformational. Even Math Twitter, oh my gosh, during its heyday, you know, was just like breathed life into me. And so this idea of communities and the individual relationships I can form from them have been really meaningful in my, I guess, current math framework, how I'm experiencing the community. But when I was younger, in my formative years, I was completely alone. I had no one. So my words of encouragement for you, if you're watching this video, would be that it is so important to choose your own metrics for success. It is so important to sort of have as a framework, what does it really mean for you to be happy and thriving and engaged in a mathematical community? There's so much stuff that we're sort of inundated with. You must win this award. You must get this grade. You must get this postdoc, this job. And on some level, I understand. But at the end of the day, like having your own internal metrics for, I feel proud of myself. I feel good about the things that I'm doing. I know that this is what a supportive community for me looks like, makes all of the difference. And then, of course, just this affirmation that you deserve to belong to an inclusive, rigorous, challenging, uplifting mathematical community. And if you have not found that place, it does not mean that it's out there. If you feel like you don't belong in mathematics, that you're not good at it, you could be reacting to the natural tension that occurs when you're in a space that's not meant for you. It does not mean those spaces aren't out there. So just, you know, you're not alone. We see you, and it's gonna be okay. And mathematics can be beautiful, and it can be used in the service of a better society. And that's the math community I want to be a part of. And I know that there are a lot of people pushing and working tirelessly to make it so that that's the case as many places as possible. And so I hope that you are encouraged by this and that you keep pushing.